4 minutos.
What's the link,
Francis?
Eu coloquei, daqui a pouco aparece.
Demora. It's not working.
Ah, pera um minuto.
Aí eu vou mandar atrás. Yeah.
Eu vou mandar
o seguinte,
Good evening, everyone. Eu vou começar a falar em português um pouquinho, depois eu uso a marcha para o inglês, para a apresentação do professor Marco Telquer. Nós estamos com um probleminha para a transmissão do YouTube. Já está.
Está online.
Está tão online?
Está.
Não, vocês não estão vendo ainda não. A imagem não saiu ainda não. Tem algum problema?
Ah, agora eu troquei.
Alguém está seguindo pelo YouTube aí?
Pronto, está aparecendo.
Estou ouvindo.
Apareceu?
Estou ouvindo, mas não vendo.
Ah, está ouvindo pelo menos. Já é um progresso. Ok.
Agora está com imagem.
Está com imagem?
Tá.
Excelente. Ok, let's give a few more minutes. So welcome to all of you. And those who are also watching via YouTube, welcome to our special lecture on philosophy of technology. Why is it important? I'm a speaker with Professor Martin Perquet, Professor of Philosophy at the University of Eindhoven and the University of Maastricht in Holland, Netherlands. Professor Perquet finished his first PhD in chemical engineering at the University of Twente. Then he worked for 16, 17 years with Philips. As a manager of factories for Philips, and then he decided that that was not challenging enough, right? And he decided to get a second PhD in economics and organizational science, and also in philosophy. And he has had an interesting and unusual professional career. He has been also the director of a psychiatric hospital in Maastricht, and now he's the CEO of Innovation Network in healthcare. So Professor Perquet has a very broad experience with engineering and also with philosophy. I met Professor Perquet when I was also teaching at the University of Eindhoven, and we have been cooperating with each other. He has been helping me to understand smart grids, because the things are getting so complex. And as a philosopher, he organizes the ideas, and has been very helpful to me. So I hope that this lecture will also be helpful to all of you here. So, Martin, welcome to our center. And you have your own.
Yes, okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Paolo, thank you very much for the invitation and for the friendly words. I'm happy to be here. Also, thank you for all the discussions we had, because the presentation I have, a couple of times I discussed it with Paul, and then he said, that's not good, and that's not good, and that's not good. Most of the times he was right, so I improved it. So I hope that's a very good presentation. As Paul already told you, I have a background in technology. But from the start of my studies, I spent a lot of time on philosophy, and my second PhD was partly in philosophy. I would like to tell you first some comments about the role of the engineer, and I will ask the question, why philosophy? Then I will present a case study about electrical infrastructures for the future. I think you are all familiar with it, And then I would like to apply some philosophy to analyze engineering practices. What's going on in engineering practices? And there are three points I want to highlight. First, what is the identity and the intrinsic values? Second, what are the interests of stakeholders, justified interests? And what about ideals, dreams, and beliefs? You see them everywhere back. Then I would like to say something about multidimensional system specifications. Then I will make a personal note, and finally with some conclusions. So let's begin with the role of the engineer. We all are engineers, and we know that technology shapes society. But we also know that society shapes technology. So there's a close interaction. And if you look at the work of engineers, I would like to say what they do is adding value to society. A good engineer adds value. And in adding value, they shape, together with many other actors, they shape the future. And I also think that good engineers contribute to a better world. And you can give a lot of examples of a better world. I gave some of them: more justice, more sustainability, more health, less poverty, and so on and so on. If you look to the work of engineers and to the effects of the inventions they do, there are a lot of interrelations between engineering and society. And therefore, I would like to also to define engineering as a cultural activity. So important is it. Then you can ask yourself, why philosophy? And I think that's a good question. Because in some circles, philosophers do not have a good image. And I understand it. Some people say, to design the future, we need engineers and not philosophers. And other people say, they are less optimistic. Engineers solve problems and philosophers create confusion. I think that's also a good one. And the last one is also a good one. Philosophers do not support engineers to make better designs. Okay, that's a part of the critics, and to be honest, I understand it. But still, I would like to ask the question, is it really? Is it really? Okay. When you ask again the question, why philosophy? Then I would like to say that philosophy has three functions, and especially that holds for philosophy of technology. The first function is an analytical function. And for example, in this case, to analyze technical products and to analyze networks. Yes, philosophers are strong in analyzing. Philosophers are also strong in criticizing, yes? And what they do is they talk over the morality of products, they question the role of managers and engineers, they analyze engineering failures, and also they discuss or criticize the role of technology in society. That's the second function. But to be honest, the most important function is the third one: to show a directional function. And for example, that is highlighting norms and values that are important for designing. It is to point a direction. What is a better technology? And I think you need the first function. You need to understand technology before you can design a better technology. But also the second function is important, because technology plays a role in society. So be critical and learn from the past. If you talk about science and technology, then I show here a slide about a basic feature of our Western culture. We generally believe that science is more important than daily experience. We believe that science tells the truth, And they experience people easily earn themselves. So their experience is not important. In the same way, a lot of people believe, they will not always express it, but that scientific theories are important and technological practices less important. These are the hierarchical relationships in Western society. And the philosophical tradition in which I was trained does not agree with this hierarchical relationship. Doeweerd, he says, for him, daily practice has a priority. And why? Because science is embedded in daily practice. Only if you look at the language, yes, in the daily practice we learn the language and we use that language to make theories, to discuss theories and all things like that. And in my opinion, and that is also read in this presentation, I don't believe in this hierarchical relationship. I think when we need to understand technology, we need to understand the technological practice. So what I want to do is to take the technological practice as a priority and a starting point. And I think that philosophers don't take the technological practice as a starting point, then they can't support engineers. Yes? Only when they take the starting point they can support. Okay, I would like to present a case study. I think you are all familiar with it, but I will say some words about it, about the electrical infrastructures for the future. I'm happy that in the discussion with Paolo, I learned a lot about it. And when we look to Western society in relation to energy supply, we face a lot of problems. And the most important problems, the increasing demand of energy, the necessity, the need of life-sustaining electrical infrastructures, and also the warming up of the Earth. That are the first problems we come to before. But if you analyze more relationships, then we can, there are related problems, the non-circular economy, the uneven distribution of wealth, and so on. Okay? We know that the infrastructure of the future will be much more complex than the present infrastructure. We also know that it has to integrate traditional energy sources, but also renewables. And we know that they have to integrate present and new distribution systems. And we know that we will have smart control systems. And the problem is, at least in the discussion with Paolo, he convinced me, he says, for us as engineers, there are no good models to really understand the whole complexity of this new system. And that's a problem. We need good models. Okay, I think you're all familiar with this type of pictures. We have here a classical power plant, but here on the houses we have solar panels, here we have wind turbines. We have here storage, and here we have storage, and here we have storage. And we have offices uses energy, houses, industrial plants, and all things like that. This is a simplified picture, but it shows that there are a lot of actors in such a smart grid system. Here you show a model. Here you see a model that has been used and still used at the Technical University. And the model basically shows three layers. Here a technical layer. This is a business layer. And here a societal layer. And you see that there are here some details. I like this model because it clearly shows that technology is interwoven with business platforms and is interwoven with society. So it makes an important distinction. And that is very good of this model. But when I would ask you, okay, I give you this model, and do you now know how to design a smart grid? I think the whole, all people would be silent. Yes? It's a good model, it shows a part of the complexity, but it doesn't help us to design. If you look at the present engineering practice, and I want to apologize because this slide has been made by Paolo, I wouldn't dare to criticize you, but he says when I look back to the engineering practices, they focus on some aspects, some components, and some requirements of governments and stakeholders. And mind or note the word some, not all, because there are no good models. And this is a reduced reality. So the danger is, when we have limited information, we design for based on a reduced reality. And that type of designs, at best they will be suboptimal. And there are in the literature articles analyzing and telling all the type of failures made in this field. And the origin of the failures is they miss relevant social aspects. They overlook important interactions between components and the network. And all these failures are expensive. We always talk about millions of dollars or euros. So there is a strong need for better models. Then the question is, can philosophy support engineers to unravel the complexity of smart grids, to design better smart grids, and to identify norms and to show the influence of values? And I think we have some models in philosophy, and I would like to present them. And again, I would like to emphasize, there is, in my view, only one way. We need to take the engineering practice as a starting point. Yes? Okay, so I told you, now I would like to focus on engineering practices. And I would like to present three perspectives, or three pair of glasses. And when you use one perspective to look at the engineering perspective or engineering practice, you see a lot of things. But when you use another perspective, you see other things. And when you use again another perspective, you again see other things. It's like when you have a normal pair of glasses and then there is yellow glasses and brown glasses, you see different things. We are here looking to a case study, renewables. And what I would like to emphasize, that every engineering practice has an identity and has own intrinsic values that are values that are inherent to this practice. It's important to understand that, because when you understand your own practice, you know much better how to design. We all know when we talk about renewables that there's solar energy, wind energy, hydro, ocean wave, hydrogen, and so on. And we all know that for the future that solar and wind will be most important, and in the coming decades it will rise sharply, the energy from these sources. I would like to identify all people who work in renewables then as a technological practice. Yes, and in the next sheet I will make it clear why I call it a practice. Yes, but first I would like to talk about the identity. What is the identity of a technological practice? Yes, when we call, for example, about the identity of a museum, you all know it is about old paintings, old statues and all things like that, yes? It's about art, yes? What is the identity of renewable energy practices? First, it is a technological practice, yes? That's all clear for you. But it is, when we zoom in more, it is about the generation of renewable energy. Well known. If we zoom in more, then we see a family of practices. Solar energy, wind energy, hydro energy, and so on. And when we look to these individual practices, now, first I have to say something about the intrinsic values. What have all these renewable energy practices in common? What have they? And now I'm talking about values. They all want to be renewable. Yes, that is very important. They all have to be safe. They have to be controllable also from a storage point of view. Yes, we also always to think about storage. And on the long term, because developments take time, then we, from an environmental point of view, they have to be acceptable. And for economic point of view, they have to be affordable. Yes, these values are intrinsic to renewables. Every engineer, I expect, knows these values. How strong the role of those values is depends. We will discuss it later. But it's important to realize that these intrinsic values should have an influence on every aspect of the renewables. Let me give one simple example about economics. We know what the price is of 1 kWh of sun power, yes? And we know that at this moment wind energy is more expensive. But we also know that for every new generation of windmills, we get the price will be 20% lower, so or 15%. So if we have 2 or 3 more generations, then the price will have dropped with 50%. So all that kind of things you can use to estimate whether you will reach the goals you want to reach. And then the next question is, on which aspects of the design have they a strong influence? And what sort of influence? I said that if you look to the different practices, it are a family of practices. And we discussed that, Paul and Nick, this afternoon extensively. If you look to the different renewable sources, they are all based on different physical principles. They are based on different physical theories. They are based on different technologies. And the electricity has different electrical characteristics. They all have different environmental effects. And they all have different cost structures. And so on. What does that imply? That every renewable has its own practice, has its own culture, yes? The engineers trained in one culture have a bit different attitude than trained in another culture. And we have to realize that. And we can understand that because all these items are different. And then the question is, do professionals which live in these different practices really speak the same language? And to be honest, it was a question, and I asked it to Paolo, and he said, yes, that is true. And sometimes there are really big communication failures, thank you very much, because although they speak more or less the same language, sometimes it goes wrong because they use the same words for different things. And here it is important that at the moment that you make identity and intrinsic values more explicit, it will be more easy to communicate. But another point is that you have to promote a dialogue. When people don't meet each other, they never will understand each other's languages. Yes, so although they are both engineers, when they are working in different practices, they have to meet each other and have dialogues to understand each other. And last point, I think people work hard on it to agree and uphold standards to a higher system level. Now I would like to go to the second perspective, and that is talking about stakeholders. And I'm talking about the interest of stakeholders, because when you understand the interest, you can better understand their behavior. And I'm not talking about just interest, but talking about justified interest. Yes, I will explain that later. And I will take here a case study based on smart grids. Again, here we have the same picture, and what you see in grids, that quite different parties are connected to each other. Yes, there are parties who are producers of energy, for example, industrial parties, but also non-industrial parties like households and people who have panels on the roof. And further, there are electrical companies that transmit, distribute and store. So you see here already a lot of producers of energy, a couple of parties. But also if you look at the uses of energy, it are quite different type of uses. For example, an industry and a household, you can't compare them. And the same holds for a hospital and a church. You can't compare them. So it is a complex smart grid, many parties. And how to understand these parties? Here we have, at this moment, only analyzed or presented to parties who are themselves active in the smart grids. But there are other stakeholders. And who are the stakeholders? For example, the government. What is their relation to the smart grid? And what are their interests? And what are their main norms and values? And basically, all these questions have to be asked. And it's also right to say that all parties we discussed, the producers, the consumers of energy, that are important stakeholders. But there are important stakeholders who were not in the drawing, yes, like the government. And when you want to answer these questions, especially the question, what are their interests? What are their main norms and values? Then we have in philosophy a theory that helps us, and a theory is the theory of individuality structures. I will not explain it in more detail, but a lot of this theory is in my presentation. When you ask yourself the question, what is a society? Some people believe that a society is a well-structured unity with the state on the top. Yes? But when you look in more detail, it is not a well-structured unity. There are a lot of different structures or different associations of different entities, different structures in society who are interacting with each other. Because, for example, an industry is quite different as a government, but they are interacting with each other and they are dependent on each other. Especially the government has the right to make laws and to execute laws. An industry makes products, and the government is a much other dependent on the products. So they relate with each other and interrelate with each other. Also, industries expect from governments that they create conditions for industry. And if we now go, for example, to households, a family is quite different from an industry. And somebody who lives single is again different from a family. And if you go to a football association, is again different from a church. So if you look through the eyes or see a pair of glasses of plurality to society, you see a lot of different structures, and all these structures in fact. And then the question is, what is the nature, the specific nature of these structures? Can we understand them a bit better? And then my answer is yes, we can. For example, I already told you, let's look to the structure of a government. What they do basically is making laws and executing laws. Please also remember, also in the economic field, when they give subsidies, they first have to make a law, and then they can give a subsidy. Let's say about universities and education, they make laws about it. Let's look at healthcare, they make laws about it. And when you have a good government, these laws are just laws. And every citizen says, yes, that's a good law. The same holds for the local authorities. They are also making and executing laws. That is their main character. When we look to industry, for most industries, profit is an important motive. They want to make profit. They make an added value for society, but they also have to make a profit. So the industry is economically qualified, whereas the government was politically qualified. And if you look to healthcare, how to define healthcare? Maybe for you this is a bit strange, healthcare but morally qualified. But if you go to the basic of healthcare, what does a doctor or what does a nurse caring for the patient? Not always a medical intervention, not always giving pills or an operation. No, it's caring for the patient. And sometimes a care means an intervention, sometimes not, sometimes only listening, but it's caring for the patients. And when you talk about really caring for somebody, that is morally qualified. And a household, people are living together, yes, that's socially qualified. And a church is spiritual qualified, and leisure is social qualified. And action groups, they're always focused on environmental problems, safety, and mostly is that morally qualified. What I try to explain to you, that we have in society a lot of different structures. And here I gave some examples. And most of these structures are a stakeholder of this market, but they have different interests. The government is about juridical, industry, economical, healthcare, moral, and so on and so on. So the interests differ. And when you have a nice drawing about markets, I understand that there are a lot of customers who consume electricity, but they may be different qualified. And when you talk about authorities, they have a different qualification than an electrical company. And we have to understand that. Because when we understand, when we want to understand the behavior of the authorities, we have to understand their qualification. The same holds for a hospital. So now we can say something about, I told you we are not only talking about interests, but we are talking about justified interests. And what is, for example, a justified interest? When a local government has a dialogue with the industry, and the dialogue is about safety for man and nature, that is a justified interest, because there are laws about safety, about man, about nature, and there's a justified interest. And for example, when you have a hospital, for example, with respect to the supplier of electricity, it is not allowed that electricity goes down, for example, for intensive care. So there must be discussions and negotiations about special solutions. And that is a justified interest. Why? Because hospitals want to care for patients. And when you care for patients, it's not allowed that electricity is going down. Yes, that is the line of reasoning. And for example, with the industry, for electricity is important, a just price and a reliable delivery. And for household, especially a reliable delivery. But to be honest, there are also unjustified interests. And when I use the word unjustified, then it is a moral statement or normative statement. So be aware, I do a lot of normative statements. For example, what suppliers often try to do is a lock-in with the customer. And when you have a lock-in, it implies that if you use products from one customer, then you cannot easily replace of one supplier, you can't easily replace from one supplier to another, because when you are with one, there's not no interoperability with other items, so you need to buy all the services from one. That is lock-in. And they like lock-in, because then they can increase the prices and make more profit. I don't think that that is a justified interest. What also sometimes happens is that the prices of electricity are lowered before elections. For example, when it's about governmental facilities. I think that's an unjustified interest. Losing safety regulations to increase profit. This happens many times in industry. That's an unjustified interest. And we have to name it. Okay? Okay, now we go to the third part. When I look at you, you are not yet tired. I'm also not yet tired. I can go on for hours, but sometimes I look on my watch, because otherwise you are looking a bit angry to me. We come to the third point. And the third point that is maybe for you a bit unusual point. That is talking about ideals, dreams, and values. Or ideals, dreams, and beliefs, that's the best idea. When you take a certain perspective, or a good pair of glasses, then you see in your engineering practices, you see a lot of ideals, dreams, and values. And I would like to present a case study about sustainability. First, I would like to say something about ideals, dreams, and beliefs. First, I want to remind you that they have an existential character. Yes? They are deep in somebody's heart. Yes? Also, a lot of ideals, for example, about sustainability, dreams about a just world, they can often not rationally be legitimated. Yes, it's a belief, it's a dream. And to be honest, there's nothing wrong with beautiful dreams and good beliefs. It's also important to understand that dreams, ideals, and beliefs motivate people, but also drive people. And that's important, they drive people. And we have to understand, at least in the present society, that we have a pluriformity in ideals, dreams, and beliefs. That means there are many different ideals, dreams and beliefs. 40 years ago in the Netherlands, that was very easy. There were three groups of ideals, dreams and beliefs. Christian, socialist and liberal. Only three. And within these three groups, there were nearly no variations. Okay, somewhat, not that strong. But at this moment, do you know how many political parties we have in the Netherlands at this moment? Anybody knows? 16. So we have at least 16 one. Yes, okay. The Netherlands is a bit a strange country, I understand. But, okay. But further, I would like to emphasize, it is a soft topic. If you talk about ideals, dreams and values and beliefs, it is a soft topic. But soft topics can be quite influential. Take for example like Greenpeace. Yes. Their topics are soft, but the impact can be large. And the same holds in the dialogues with a lot of stakeholders. If you make strong mistakes in this point, it can be tough, very tough. And maybe a bit a warning, it's also a moral statement, but sometimes I like to make a moral statement, but never design a product or perform an activity that conflicts with your own ideals, dreams, values and beliefs. I've had two times in my life a boss who ordered me something to do that I really said, generally I'm rather obedient manager, at least that's my self-picture, but then I said no, that's unacceptable, I don't do that. And in one case it took 2 months before I was dismissed, and the other case it took 6 months. But okay, but never design something that goes, that conflicts with your own ideals, dreams and beliefs. The development of technology is strongly influenced by these soft features. And this holds for every technology, yes? Not only for sustainability. For sustainability it comes strongly to the fore, but it holds for every technology. At this moment I have a PhD student and he is investigating the ideals, dreams and beliefs behind healthcare portals. Yeah? Healthcare portals on the internet. So they are vivid. Yes, it's everywhere present. Okay, but especially they come to the fore in the Netherlands. And if you look, and now I've not taken, later on I will say something about different companies, but if you look to the Dutch situation, at this moment the neoliberal parties, they believe in the free market and they believe in limited regulation. The result is that they are passive with respect to sustainability. Passive. Yes, and they have a neoliberal government at this moment. Religious party believe in care for the creation. Yes, they don't talk about reality, they talk about creation. And they also promote the idea of stewardship. Yes, you are responsible for what you are doing. They are active with respect to sustainability. Green parties emphasize the care for nature and care for next generations. And Greenpeace is strongly driven by their ideology. So you see that if you look to politics, there are different ideals, dreams and beliefs. But also in the Netherlands, if you go to the producers of energy, some of them are fully green. And they promote it. We are green. And they say, we want to care for nature and we want to care for next generations. But there are also producers who still use old coal generators. And they try also to use the language of the green society, but they fail. Yeah, because they don't show it. So be aware that behind policies and behind factories, or better in factories, are ideals and are beliefs and are dreams. The next question is, okay, when there are ideals, dreams and beliefs, what is their influence? Because they will influence the design of the smart grid or the design of other items, yes. And on what aspects do they have an influence? And what sort of influence? Okay, up to now, I have told you a lot. I told you I will look at engineering practices. And I've used three different perspectives, or three different pair of glasses. First was about identity and intrinsic values. The second about inclusion of justified interest. And the third one about ideals, dreams and beliefs. And if you are looking from these three perspectives, then you will understand a lot of the activities, or better, all activities in engineering practice. But if you analyze them, or if you want to develop, to design the electrical infrastructure of the future, how to integrate these three perspectives. Okay, that's the next step. And that's a step we have developed also together with Paolo in the past days. First, I want to have a short recapitulation. We talked about intrinsic values. And we asked the question, on which aspects of the design do we have an influence? We talked about stakeholders. And we said that every stakeholder has an own focus, juridical, economic, social, and so on. And we talked about ideals, dreams, and beliefs. When you ask the question, on which aspect of the design do they have an influence? So again, the question how to integrate the three I's. Okay, that is a new topic, how to integrate it. And the answer is that we will develop multi-dimensional system specifications. I will explain what it is. Yes, and here's a small piece of philosophy, and that is based on this theory of model aspects, but I will not go into detail. But what is important in this philosophy, they make a distinction between products and entities on the one hand, and aspects or dimensions on the other hand. Yes, that distinction is very important. And what does that say? It implies that an entity or a product is a thing with its own nature and own character. And every entity or product functions in different aspects. Yes, when we talk about electricity, it functions in the economic aspect because it has a price. It functions in the juridical aspect because if something goes wrong, yes, there will be a police investigation and all things look like that. It functions also in the social aspect because when the light goes down, it's very difficult for people to interact again and to communicate with each other. And in this theory, it is said that there are about 15 different aspects. And everything, every product, has to be characterized by these 15 aspects. And I will show them to you. And that you find here. We start at the bottom, numerical, spatial, kinematical, about velocity, physical, biotic, sensitive, logical, about power of shaping, linguistic, social, economic, aesthetical, juridical, moral, and trust. What does this say? This philosopher says that every human being, functions in these 15 aspects. For example, I can be for you a trustful person or not. Yes, and you can have a judgment about my moral behavior. And you can say something about, let me say, the aesthetics of my clothing. And you can say, okay, it's beautiful or it's not beautiful. But to be honest, there is aesthetics is somewhat different from economics. You can't reduce aesthetics to economics. Can you see this shirt? Is this very expensive or very cheap? Can you see it? Do you think it's a beautiful one? Maybe I have to ask the women, but I will not do it now. But it implies sometimes that when I'm buying a new shirt, sometimes I come in a shop and the prices are very high. And I say to my wife, ooh, that's ugly. Yes. That's a really old man. Yes, and when I come in other shops, they are much more beautiful, there are different items in it, and they have this type of color ties and all things like that. So it implies that the aesthetical aspect is different from the economic aspect. And we all know it's for windmills, it holds in the same. And also it holds for sun panels. When you have sun panels on your roof, and they will be red, I don't think a lot of people like it. When they are gray or black, that's much better, yes? So, what does the theory say? That you have 15 different aspects. And everything functions in 15 aspects. That means a smart grid, you can identify 15 aspects. A windmill, you can identify 15. My pair of glasses, you can identify 15, yes? I will not do it now, but it's quite clear. And the first one, we sometimes call the physical structure. Then the biotic structure, sensitive structure, and these all together are the acting structure. Yes, the actions of human being. Okay, this is about multidimensional specifications. And now I come to the next step. How to integrate all what we found with respect to the three eyes. What we have to do is to determine the influence of intrinsic values of different stakeholders and ideals and dreams and beliefs on every aspect. Yes? When a product or network functions in 15 aspects, engineers have to understand them all and have to know them all. In other words, you see ice crystallize or boil down into a multi-dimensional specification. And I will give you not an extensive example, but only some examples. Here, very beautiful, for example, the biotic aspect. Biotic is about life, about environment. And what do you know about the biotic aspects of windmills? Is there anybody who knows it? I heard on the radio a beautiful story. First, an ugly story, or bad story, is that windmills, especially on sea, I'm talking about windmills on sea, that's bad for birds. But do you know it is good for fishes? Because fishes go there and they can't be caught by fishermen. So in the areas of the windmills, there are much more fishes than in the area without windmills. But it shows that when you are talking about windmills, you have to understand and to discuss the influence of a windmill on the biotic life. When we do to the analytical aspect, for example, or the rational aspect, that's about rational distinctions, about analytical approaches. Then you need good models for smart grids, but also for windmills. You need really good, rational, understandable models. That is the analytical aspect. When I will not have them all, but again, the aesthetic aspect. When you talk about solar panels, when they have a good color that more or less matches with the house, that's much more easy to buy them. When we have, for example, the moral aspect, morality is about caring for. And we know that with electricity, safety is very important. But also we know why we want to have renewable energy. It has to be with the warming up of the earth. So I can't go into detail, but my message is that if you analyze it, each aspect has an own nature and an own normativity. And I'm sorry that there are 50. I've done a lot of trials to reduce them to, let's say, 10. Or to reduce them to 3. I've been a manager for many years, and you know, I don't know whether you know it, maybe there are managers here in the room, but managers never want to know more than 3. Because that's easy to count and to remember. And when I was a manager, I also preferred only 3 things and not 50. Yes, that's ridiculous. But I'm sorry, I tried to reduce that, but it is impossible. And when you know the philosophical background behind it, it is impossible. But what I want to show, that when you investigate technological practices, you can investigate them from 3 perspectives. These perspectives learn you a lot about electrical infrastructure, and you can integrate them, you can let them crystallize in this multidimensional normativity. I would like to make a short note about my own house, because maybe you're thinking he's talking about sustainability. Does he know anything about it? Yes, I know a thing about it. This is my home, and I've here 15 panels, and here 10 panels. This is not possible because when the sun is there, the shadow of this tree is here, and here must be a large distance, otherwise you have the problem of the shadow of the chimney, and in total I've installed 6,000 watt peak. That is too much, but I hope in 5 years, maybe 10 years, I don't know how quick technology goes, but then I want to have an electric car, or I want to have a heat pump, and I will show you why. I did also a lot of re-insulation of the roof, the walls, the floors. My house is built in 1985. It was insulated according to the standards of the time, so it was well insulated. But in comparison with the present standards, it's bad insulated. So I re-insulated it. Cost a lot of money. For example, I also replaced the old fireplace with an efficiency of 10 to 20% by a closed fireplace with a fan. You see here that has an efficiency of 70 to 80%. And I've also triple glass for doors, and I have very good insulated doors. And what was the effect of the use of natural gas? You see it here from 1997 to 2016-2017. This is a forecast. But here was the mean use about 3,200 cube natural gas. I started here to do something. Here it dropped strongly below 50%, and here we did some more activities. We used also more the open furnace, so it's now around 1100. Yes, and in the future, when we have better heat pumps, air water heat pumps, then the overflow of electricity I will use for these pumps. And I have more space on my roof. So, but at this moment, the technology of the heat pumps is not yet good enough. 5 years ago, I did an investigation. It was not at all possible. Now it is possible, but not that good and very expensive. So I wait 3 to 4 years, and then I will do that. Okay, I come to the conclusions. Why philosophy of technology? Again, to ask the question. I've shown to you, you can analyze have watched all the practices. You can analyze the world of an engineer, and that's what I try to do. But also criticize. You can criticize especially one-sided approaches. And that can be a one-sided approach from the perspective of technology, but also for the perspective of economy, but also with respect to ideals, dreams, and values. And then you have the directional function. You can support engineers to understand the complexity of design, to make them sensible for norms and values, and to develop better designs. So, and I told you that the engineering practices, there are three perspectives to investigate them, and what you find here, you can boil down, you can crystallize in a multi-dimensional specification. And I would like to thank you for your attention. Okay?
Thank you, Mark. Thank you very, very much. I like especially your last citation.
Yes, I especially did choose it for you. Thank you.
We have time for a few questions. Who would like to be the first one to question Professor Terkerk on the philosophy of technology? Professor Monat.
Well, thanks, Professor Perkerk. I'm pretty much interested in the way values can impact the outcome. For example, in our university, we are aiming to teach students to develop skills regarding technology. For example, electrical engineers, they should master the Ohm's law, the Kirchhoff laws, and all the techniques to design a good network. But when they don't have the proper values, I think we fail not only on giving them the skills, but to make them better citizens, better people. What they're going to do with those skills may not be good. So, how philosophy of technology can help us as educators to, you know, build values before building knowledge?
Thank you, Professor Donato. That's a very difficult question, because basically you are discussing educational systems. Yes, because you want to build citizens. And when you ask me, which is my personal opinion, what is the objective of a university is not to deliver standardized students who know the law of Ohm and all things like that, yes? I think one of the important challenges of a university is to deliver, to say it in that way, good engineers. Engineers who have a personality, who have virtues, yes? And when you have the good virtues, you do the good thing. They have in Germany the beautiful word for education, Bildung. Bildung is something like shaping, yes? You want to shape the character of a student, yes? You want them, a student want to understand it, that he want to contribute to society, that he would to work on a good society. Yes, all these type of values. I think that basically it begins in the family where you grow up, yeah, basically. But I think also universities can do a good job. I once had a boss, and he asked me, and was a smart guy. He did earn a lot of money, and he was very smart. And he said to me, "Martin, what are you doing in the evenings?" And he knew that I didn't work any evening for the company. He wanted that, but I was a factory manager. And factory managers have often a lot of work to do because most of the money from a business go on in the factory. Yes, there they add a lot of money. And I said, okay, sometime you might read something about philosophy, and I'm now writing an article about ethics, about management and ethics. And he said to Martin, I don't understand that there's any relationship between management and ethics. I don't understand. And okay, I think okay. And I tried to finalize the discussion because I thought, okay, it is useless. It was also the boss who sometimes was for 3 weeks on the business trip, and he had small kids, 3 weeks. And sometimes I said to him, why do you work so hard? You have kids. But okay, when he said to me, there is no relationship between ethics and management. And then after that, he dismissed Philippinian employees because in effect in Taiwan, because he could get Chinese employees who were a bit cheaper from one way or another way. I think that has to do with virtues. Be faithful also to your employees. And when you have an economic problem, try to discuss it and do it in a very good way. So I think I fully agree, let me say, with your question, because behind your question is a certain view. And I think there's a beautiful challenge for this university. And I can tell you that universities in England and in the Netherlands have also a lot of problems with this challenge. I work on the Maastricht University College. It's a very nice environment, and they really want shape characters, to use that word. But there are teachers who always say to students, you have to obey me. I don't want to have dialogues, do what I tell you. It is impossible, that type of teachers, but there are that type of teachers. So you have the chance to do better than Europe, okay?
Thank you. All right, time for one more question.
First of all, thank you very much. On behalf of the students, I'd like to thank you very much. Because from the very beginning, they could think that what do Plato, Kant, Aristotle have to do with my PhD program? And what does philosophy have to do with that? And I think your presentation was very good in order to help them to understand. That first point. I have a question which somehow similar to Bonatus. Because sometimes we see people that say that they claim to be very good to help people, but they don't pay taxes. Sometimes they own huge companies, they become famous for having institutions or other things to promote people, especially poor people. So my question is similar. Assuming, for example, that an engineer asks you, why do I need to know philosophy? Because if I have regulators, if I have a good regulation in my system, I won't be able to destroy the environment because I have some regulations about environmental restrictions, for example. So all I need to know is how to be a good engineer in the sense of designing things I'm supposed to design. I don't need to care about that because other people are supposed to help me. How do you face this kind of problem, please?
So basically you are saying that when I interpret your question right, that a lot of managers will tell to the engineers, okay, there are regulations, follow the regulations, it's not necessary to know ethics by yourself and all things like that. Yeah, so follow the rules and the regulations. Partly I understand that managers say it, but managers must not forget that technology develops much more quicker than the law. Yes, there are 5 to 10 years between it. And when you cannot convince a manager about ethics, and I have had bosses, I could not convince them about ethics. And once one of my bosses had a proposal and I said, from an ethical point of view, I'm sorry, it's unacceptable. And he became angry. And I said, I don't want to talk about ethics, I want to talk about economics. Okay. I said, okay, at least I closed my eyes, I shut my mouth, and I was terrible angry. But the next time, when we had again, I'm sorry, a stupid proposal, I changed my strategy and I said, maybe it's a good proposal, but it costs a lot of money. And the result was the same, he didn't do. So an important point is that managers can be short-sighted to think that when the engineers follow the law, that they can keep a lot of money in their pockets. But when they make a mistake, when they are not aware, for example, from the environmental consequences, and when there is no law, or when there is a law, when they follow the law and still it goes wrong, the financial consequences will be tremendous. Yes? We have a lot of examples where the financial consequences are tremendous. And I can easily say there's a lot of literature about it, but many managers don't want to know that literature, to be honest. That when you have motivated engineers and they work motivated, they manage them in the right way, and it also implies ethics, dialogues, time for dialogues, they deliver better products than engineers who function within well-defined frames. And on the long term, that type of managers always will lose a lot of money. And especially in companies that focus on lowering of the costs. I worked in a Philips factory and it was sold to a Taiwanese. And Taiwanese bought our factory because we were so innovative. But what did they do? They did apply all the management styles for the effective factories to innovation. And within 2 years it was away. Yes. And that people, that manager said, we manage costs, and we manage all regulations and proper investigation to engineers on the rule is not important. So I think, I know there are a lot of managers who only think in financial terms, but it is really a pity, because society is more than about financials. And there's a beautiful statement, I never saw a dollar laugh. Yes. So if we only this statement show how short-sighted it is. And on the other hand, I have to add that, and I'm aware about that, because it took me a couple of years to develop together with other philosophers what I have told you. Yes? So philosophy, it is not easy to connect philosophy or ethics with technology. That's not that easy. But it is a struggle. But if you don't struggle, then you will never learn it. So the struggle is, struggling with this type of topics is an inherent to the life of an engineer. And then sometimes he's unsure, is that a good choice or that a good choice, but then you discuss it with each other. And I think the most important point is the open discussion between engineers. Yes, and also an open discussion with people with, from other disciplines. Their innovations will grow. Also discussion with stakeholders, with customers. If engineers never meet stakeholders or customers, that's wrong. Then they don't get ideas. They have a lot of discussions with customers. They will get new ideas and have discussions with the government. Sometimes, let me tell you about environmental regulations. Sometimes when I was a factory, there was a new regulation, and then it costed a lot of money, yes. But then I said to the engineers, okay, redesign the process, but it must be 25% more effective. They didn't like it, what I said, but finally they succeeded. So then I had two things. I had there from an environmental point of view a very good process, and it was 25% cheaper, so the efficiency told the environmental problems. So when you have a more integrated approach, you can do a much better job, but then you must be open for it. Is that a good answer? Okay, thank you.
Perhaps one more question? If not, let me just tell you, Martin, a few things, couple of things. And coming back to Professor Bonato's point, it takes time to develop this culture. But several years ago, in conversations with Martin, I decided, and you, Bonato, knows very well, to start and to promote to create panels within the Power Engineering Society, Power and Energy Society, during the general meeting to discuss these issues. And for 5 years in a row now, we have been doing this. And Martin was the person who said, go and get this started. This past summer meeting, the IEEE came to me and said, you need to write a book on this topic. Ethics and philosophy within the context of power and energy. And I'm glad that we accepted, together with Martin and now Professor David Rogers, we accepted the challenge. And within 2 or 3 years, right, Martin, we should have the first book on ethics of power and energy. And that's one of the things. It takes time. Right? It takes time to get those things. So Wiley is on board with us, and we should be able to finish this. Martin, I'm delighted that you could come and join us here and give us this brilliant insight into philosophy. It is important. Like friendship, it gives value to survival and to a better society. Thank you so much, Mike.
Good. Last slide, that was a surprise for you. It's a very test. I changed it on the last day.